this video, I'm gonna tell you about 6 reasons why I really don't like the Amazon program FBA, fulfilled by Amazon. Now, keep in mind, I actually have never tried to do FBA before, but those are things I'm gonna tell you about in a second, and reasons why I haven't tried FBA. Now, I know a lot of people have found great success with FBA, and there's a lot of stories out there about, you know, awesome case studies. People are making, you know, 6 or 7 figures per month and they're doing great. And that's fantastic. But for me, I'm not very enthusiastic about it. So before we get started, I want to let you know the question of the day. If you happen to be an FBA expert or, you know, actually doing FBA currently, something like that, do let me know in the comments the pros and cons that you see or that you've heard about for FBA. Even if you're not an expert, go ahead and put your opinion in anyway. My name is Doug Cunnington. I talk about affiliate marketing and project management and a little productivity thrown in there too. Now, before I tell you the 6 reasons why I don't really like FBA, and by the way, a lot of people say Amazon FBA, which is a little redundant. It's fulfilled by Amazon, so that would be Amazon fulfilled by Amazon is a little redundant, but we'll just say FBA and I'll try and stick to that. I'm gonna tell you about some of the great things about FBA, because there are a lot of benefits to go with that model over other physical product models that are out there. Number one, Amazon handles the fulfillment. So that means shipping's fast, people know what to expect. A lot of people have Amazon Prime and they're gonna be able to like get their product in a couple days, which is fantastic. So obviously that's a pro. All the fulfillment, all the transactional stuff handled by Amazon. Makes it much easier on you. Number two, in a sort of related way, shipping is cheap. So again, in a lot of ways, you know, Amazon handling all the transactional shipping and handling and all that stuff makes it a lot cheaper and just in general easy for you to deal with. So it's cheaper to ship, it's cheaper for the end consumer as well. And three, this one's kind of obvious, Amazon is a huge marketplace. So if you put your products on Amazon, there will be eyes on it. And even if it's a flop in many ways, you're probably still gonna sell a few units. I know a few of my friends that have tried FBA, maybe it was their first time around, they've never ordered a product before, and they ended up still selling quite a few of them, quite a few of whatever their product was, and it worked out generally okay. Now let's get to the 6 reasons why I don't really like the FBA program. So keep in mind, for most of these 6, my reference point is an Amazon affiliate site. So when you have that in mind, that's sort of our benchmark and comparison. So number one, the FBA program is generally capital intensive. So that means your startup costs are probably going to be higher. Why is that the case? So number one, you have to buy the inventory. So you literally like buy the products and then have it shipped to wherever, you know, the warehouse is. We'll get into some of the details in a second. And Amazon stores that inventory for you. So you literally own the products. So you have to buy them, and it's not like a drop shipping situation where, you know, you don't buy the products, you just serve as an intermediary. It's not like that. You buy the products in the FBA program. If you want to like grow your, you know, monthly revenue, you have to basically keep reinvesting or invest more money into more products so that you can sell more each month. All right. So just in general, you have to keep rolling over your profits. Now, that's kind of business 101. If you want to grow your business, you have to reinvest or have other growth mechanisms in there, and investing more capital is an obvious way to do it. However, I have like a really poor business background. I have an engineering degree, so I didn't really take any business classes. So this wasn't immediately obvious to me. The point is, once you start making money, once you start pulling in revenue, a lot of times you can't, you know, take profits out for quite some time until you keep reinvesting. Number two, there's a huge amount of competition on Amazon. I got started with internet marketing back in 2013. And obviously internet marketing had been around for a very long time at that point. In 2013, I heard so much about FBA over and over again, and I went the route of Amazon affiliate marketing. It was just a little bit cheaper to start up and less risk overall. Simpler concepts, at least to me as well. Now, for the FBA side, it's sort of mature now. I mean, that's been, you know, 5 years at this point when I'm recording this. I've been hearing about FBA. There have been courses, many courses on FBA, And while it's still, you know, something that you can get into, there are companies that started in, you know, 2010 or 2013 or whenever FBA actually was a thing, and they've been able to continually refine their process, get better, potentially add, you know, more and more products and iterate on, you know, the success that they were already having back in 2013. So they're like 5 years ahead of you. Now, no matter what you get into, there's going to be competition, but at the, you know, the amount of money that can be made with FBA, there are people that have reinvested to like solidify their position, make their company more defensible, and, you know, really they don't want to lose their top spot as, you know, a product seller of, you know, whatever niche they're in. Let's go for a little example here. So I recently bought an iPhone case, and if you go to Amazon and just Google iPhone case, you'll see so many different examples of extremely similar products. I mean, the products look almost identical except for, you know, maybe the text on the product and a couple little details. So at that point where it's a commodity, it's very competitive, right? It's all these are the same and just there's tiny differences. The prices are virtually the same as well. Now, if you're going for a huge volume of sales, maybe that works out well for you, but you know, that's another story. But basically, you know, my takeaway there is if you want to, you know, have less competition, you probably need to like sort of develop your own category, like they mention in the 22 immutable laws of marketing. If you could come up with your own like specific category and have your own like little thing that, you know, only you do, like an iPhone case that also can keep your beer cold, like that sort of thing, like something that no one else has even thought of before. That's a great idea. I'm not sure how that would work in the car or anything. But the point is, if you could come up with your own category, less competition, that'd be a way around it. But nevertheless, if you go look at a lot of different products out there, you'll see that there are, you know, a lot of products that are super similar and really hard to differentiate between, you know, which one's better. Number three reason I don't like FBA, in general, it's a little more hands-on than an affiliate site. Now, this is up for, you know, your own opinion and, you know, how much experience you have with managing supply chain and understanding shipping and dealing with customs and stuff like that. And by the way, most of the time in an FBA situation, people are shipping their product from China, usually on a ship. It arrives somewhere at some port, and then you have to get it over like through customs, and then you have to get it over to an Amazon warehouse, right? So it's just, you know, all are little problems to solve, but if you have zero experience in any one of those areas, there's a little bit more of a learning curve. Now, again, this is a personalized list, like just for me, my six reasons. And I already understand a lot about the affiliate marketing area. So for me to learn the new things, it would be like starting over in a new business that I literally know very little about. So from my perspective, the FBA program is more like time intensive. Now, I am a project manager and I've hired lots of people and I've set up teams and systems, and I'm certain there's a way you could hire a manager and maybe an assistant as well. They potentially could have experience in, you know, retailing and, you know, importing, exporting, that sort of stuff. And if you're able to, you know, hire someone that you can trust to manage the supply chain for you, or at least pieces of it, that would go very long way to like free up your time a little bit. In a lot of ways, you know, people try and figure out how to make money online so they can have a little more free time. Not so they could create another job for themselves where they're working, you know, 12 or 15 hours a day, even when they don't really like want to. And that's the thing. I mean, sometimes I do put in 12 or 13 hour days, but it's rare, and it's usually when I'm like in the zone and I'm having a good time working on whatever it is I'm working on. With the, you know, you compound the couple items that I just mentioned, and all of a sudden you're like, I have to manage the supply chain and make sure, you know, my products are running low in the warehouse. I can see that they're running low. Sales are going up and I need to get more product from China. So at that point, you're kind of frantically trying to get the materials, the products over, and there's nothing you could do because they're on a ship. You know, you can't make it go any faster. Now, of course, there are ways around it, but the point is, a lot of times, FBA is going to be more time intensive than an affiliate site. Managing the supply chain is number four. If you happen to be an industrial engineer or like a supply chain expert, this is probably a fun problem for you to solve. you have, you know, all these variables in place and a few like failure points, and it's probably a fun process for you. It's not that complicated when you think of, you know, the logistics for a big company. So if your experience is in, say, logistics or supply chain, this may be a really fun thing for you to get into. But for me, when I started hearing about dealing with the product suppliers, the shipping, customs, getting the material from, you know, the customs area to the warehouse, it sounded less fun. Just in general, it sounded like less fun. Again, all problems to solve, and they are probably easily solvable if you know how to do it. But from my perspective, I wasn't particularly interested in figuring out how to solve all those problems. And then, of course, like I mentioned before, if your product is selling well, your inventory is dwindling, and then you may have to get products in before you anticipated that happening. Because, you know, things could happen fast. If, say, your product's great, a couple bloggers cover it, or maybe you're doing outreach to have bloggers cover that product, at that point, you may sell way faster than you expected. Number five, that leads us to what happens when your products are out of stock. So let's say you are selling a lot of products. Maybe Amazon is recommending your product a little bit more. Maybe you're running ads too. But at that point where you start running out of products and customers are not able to buy, sort of the velocity of your sales goes down, of course, because you don't have as much to sell. It, you know, at some point you run out and you can't sell anymore. You probably are not going to be recommended as much. If you're, you know, you'll have to stop running the ads, and your general velocity of sales is going to go down, which is kind of a bad thing. Now, my understanding is you could probably recover it, you know, once you get the momentum back. But if you are in a competitive set of products or a category, there may be people, you know, right below you waiting to take your place, and maybe they have good momentum and they're able to take your place. Or let's say it's one of the bigger competitors in the category that just added the product that you have because they see that it's selling well. At that point, they may have more money, more inventory, more know-how to like overtake you. So when you run out of product, it's kind of a bad thing. And if you are new to managing the supply chain, then maybe that's not like so unlikely. You may just run into an issue where you run out of your product and you have to, you know, scramble to figure out what to do. And last, and this is probably the biggest point, it's a distraction. So let me make an assumption about like a lot of people that get started with online marketing or some sort of, you know, entrepreneurship stuff related to online marketing. When I got started, I was really intrigued with all the different opportunities out there. And that's the thing, there are dozens of opportunities, right? There are so many things, and even in a little area of the internet, you'll find a lot of different topics covered. For example, FBA, Amazon affiliate marketing, affiliate marketing in general, maybe a focus on ClickBank products. Then you have online courses. You can also do drop shipping, for example. You can write Kindle books, and the list goes on, right? Those are just a couple that I came up with off the top of my head, but there are tons of opportunities out there. And usually when people get started, they try too many. And I was guilty of this. I'm maybe still guilty of it now, but the more things you're trying to do, the longer it'll take you to do any of them. And in a lot of instances, you're probably going to quit most of them in the long run, and you won't get any like great experience from it, all right? I mean, you can do each one of those things, but you can't do each one of those things all at the same time. So my advice is to pick one. And if you want to do FBA, I say go all in, study FBA. There's tons of material on the topic. You can, you know, check out YouTube channels, there's podcasts, there are, you know, full-on courses that cost a couple $100s, and there's some that cost several $1,000s. So I say go for it if you're interested, but be sure to shut out all the other distractions. Don't try and do too much stuff at once. I know a lot of people think they can handle multiple projects, but it turns out most people can't. We all think we can do a little bit more. Again, I'm in this camp as well. I always think I can do more than I actually can. So the less you do, the more you can focus on one thing, the better. Now, in closing, I do want to mention that, again, I haven't done FBA before. I've always been able to shut that out just because there was so much new material that I would have to learn that I just thought, hey, I'm just going to stay away for now. But the thing is, lots of people have had great success with FBA. Now, when you do see the case studies, remember, a lot of times people will only tell you their top line revenue, which is cool. You know, let's say someone's making, you know, seven figures, are making like $1 million a month top line revenue. You know, when you cut through it all, they may be spending a lot on ads. Of course, they have to pay their inventory. So the profits are really important. So when you hear these big headlines, remember, a lot of times you're only hearing the top line revenue, not the bottom line profits. And you don't really have a picture of how much time was put into it or anything like that. So they make great headlines, but it's a little bit misleading, especially if you're just getting started and you wouldn't know to ask that question. The question of the day is, what are the pros and cons in your opinion of FBA? Again, if you're an expert, really want to hear your opinion. And you know what? If you are an armchair FBA person, that's cool too. Just let me know what you think. Really interested to get your opinion on the topic. And if you're new to the channel, have a look around. I mostly talk about Amazon affiliate marketing, project management, productivity. And if you like what you see, please subscribe.